Hey, Park Cities, we're so glad to be here today for your Season of Joy virtual event. I'm here with my mom, Dorothy Wilkinson. Obviously myself, I'm Cynthia Yanoff, and my daughter, Kate Yanoff. And we are excited to talk to you about leaving a legacy of faith, that idea of generational faith. And it may seem a little bit dry, but we promise that we've got some insight, hopefully that will help you as you move forward in your days. And so we're going to start by asking a question of each of us. And the question is, what in your lifetime has shaped your faith? And so we'll start with my mom.
Okay, it's good to be here today. And I am one of those fortunate ones that I have a history, a legacy of Christian grandparents. A couple of years ago when we went to Colorado, we went back through Boulder, and we went to the cemetery where my grandparents are buried. And I really didn't realize my grandfather was buried next to my grandmother. I looked at the date. He was born in 1865.
Wow.
That's the Civil War.
Wow.
But, you know, he was a Baptist minister. Probably not a very good preacher. I have his sermon books, and they're not the best. And they moved around a lot. But because of that legacy that he gave to my mother, that my mother and father passed on to me, I am so grateful for the legacy that I have, you know, through my grandparents. And then there's my parents, of course, and they were the greatest influence in my life. my mother and father both taught Sunday school. My father was chairman of every committee. They were so active in the church, and they had us in the church every time the doors opened. I remember going to GA's, a mission organization. I remember going to training union at night where we did Bible drills. In fact, we've called this from Bible drill to Bible apps. We did Bible drill. We gave parts. And then we would all go down two blocks to the Methodist church because they danced on Sunday night and Baptists didn't dance. And so that was an important part of my growing up, but it was really my parents. My father was the most honest man, moral man. He was always the pastor's best friend because he raised cattle and he always kept their freezer full of beef. But more importantly, when he was chairman of the building committee that built the building, the day before it opened, he was on his hands and knees planting grass around the church. And that was the kind of people that they were. My mother, you know, pretty is as pretty does. Actions speak louder than words, those saying. So they gave us a strong biblical and moral foundation to our lives. And their lives were a beacon in our community. And as a result, helped me come to faith in Christ. So I have a long legacy of Christian grandparents and parents, which I am so grateful for.
Yeah, that's amazing. And so similarly, growing up in your home with my mom and my dad, Tom Wilkinson, I would say obviously the church had a pivotal role in my faith. I feel like I was born on the cradle roll. I remember being at church on Sunday mornings and Sunday nights and Wednesday nights, and I think there was Tuesday night visitation. There wasn't an opportunity when the doors were open that my parents didn't bring us along. I might say drag us along if I'm honest, but I am so thankful for being involved in the church and what I learned at the church. And I did GAs and ACT teens and youth ski trips, and we went to a place called Glorietta that I love. We had lock-ins. So many different areas that I had the opportunity to be fed the Word of God, but like you, Mom, it was my mom and dad. I think it's my parents that made the difference, my family, because my family really taught us what it looked like to live for the Lord. And whether that was having people at our house at Thanksgiving, there wasn't a person my mom wouldn't invite over for Thanksgiving that didn't have somewhere to be. Or whether that was my dad always wheeling out people in their wheelchairs to their cars after church, helping people that were older around their homes. Just, I remember my parents having films at their homes, like the old projectors, and you played Dobson films or something on parenting, and they would bring in couples to talk parenting. But just seeing their faith played out every day, that has shaped my faith, and I'm just so grateful that your legacy passed down to me. And then we go to Kate. It's scary to ask your teenage daughter, who's a senior in high school, to speak into this, but we're going to let her for a minute.
Well, I think that similarly to both of y'all, I think being raised in the church had a very big impact on me. And just, I remember I always went to VBS every year. Even after I was too old to go to VBS, I would serve in VBS. And so I think that that was amazing. And just going to church camps like Pine Coast, Sky Ranch, Wednesday night youth group, being in the church choir. And so I think that that just helped me from a young age to just get to know the gospel and all of that. And then I think that most recently, I would say technology has also had a very large impact on my life. I mean, technology has just been such a force that can connect me to other Christians that I never would have met on my own. And so I think like social media, blogs, podcasts, and just all of that has been a very big force to drive me closer to Christ. And then, but I think first and foremost, just like both of y'all, I think that my family has just strengthened my relationship with Christ. Just seeing my parents serve, my family adopted my youngest brother, JB, and just seeing my parents do that foster care journey and their service and devotion. And I also think just seeing my mom run her nonprofit, ChristianParenting.org, and have a podcast and just speak into other people's lives has really impacted me.
So I think you get a little bit of a peek behind the curtain of what the three generations of faith have looked like in our family. Blair, I'm going to retape that because I'm fixing my hair. Sorry. There's something in my lipstick. Okay. After Kate, I'm going to start it right there. So I hope that gives you a little bit of a peek behind the curtain of what different generations of faith have looked like in our family. And I think it's probably similar in your families. There's so many of us that kind of have this same story. It's such a great story. And obviously, the church is so pivotal in our faith and shaping our faith, and we're so grateful for that. But then there's differences too. My mom had WMU and Training Union and a lot of those programs that we don't do anymore. I remember all the youth group stuff and VBS that helped kind of bring me up, some that we still do. But then you hear my daughter talk about some of the technology that's really helped her with podcasts, and there's Bible apps. And so what we see is how the methodology changes over the years. But what doesn't change is the gospel story, the gospel truth. And what I love is that thread that's woven in all of our stories, the thread of family, of our moms and our dads that believed in the gospel, that understood what the Lord meant and why it was significant to have God in our lives. And they passed that down through really real, invisible, and tangible ways to each of us and passing it down the generations. That's the common thread. And that's what we kind of want to talk about today. When we were so graciously asked to come and speak at this event, which we're thrilled to be here, my mom and I kept coming back to wanting to talk about that legacy of faith, passing down generationally our faith. And what does that look like? How do we do that well? And I think what's important to note is first, we've got to stay relevant. Just like the methodology has changed over the years that the church brings programs, we need to stay relevant on what kids are facing, what parents are facing. Let's know what we're dealing with going into this as we try to pass down our faith. And so I start by saying, let's be aware of that. I think you need me to tell you that our culture is further away from Christian values than it's ever been. And from what I understand and reading studies, that probably my children's generation will be the first generation that's in this country persecuted for their Christian faith. And so we're walking up against this line of a new generation, a new type of faith that's going to need to be stronger, that's going to need to be firmer in what they believe. So as we're raising up this next generation of church, that's one of the obstacles of our culture. But then we're also dealing with kids that have an epidemic within themselves of anxiety and depression. 70% of teens asked, what's the number one thing that's plaguing or that's difficult for your generation? 70% say it's the anxiety and the depression they face. And so we've got this going on with the culture. We've got kids that are struggling with anxiety and depression. And then we have parents. I'm so grateful that I get to speak into the parenting realm with the ministry I'm involved in. And what I've learned from talking to parents is parents are stretched to the margins because there's so much they're facing that we've never faced before. We're raising kids. I'm in the first generation of raising kids that have technology, internet access completely at their hands 24/7. There's pornography issues. We're dealing with video games. We're dealing with social media, cyberbullying. You go through all the things in addition to what's already been going on. There's the school shootings that we've suffered with. We look at the religious issues. We look at the racial divide. There's so much in our culture. And parents are struggling. Then you put a pandemic on top of it. It's hard. These are hard days. Now, that's not to say all the news is doom and gloom. But I think we've got to be aware that more than ever, it's going to take all of us. It's going to take parents and grandparents and great-grandparents and the family to come together to raise up our kids to know the Lord, because these are hard and challenging days. And we all have something to add to this generational passing down of the faith. When I was looking at different studies recently, there's one that kind of caught my eye, and it talks about within Christian families. And I think this is news that we need to be aware of. Within Christian family, research shows that kids that grow up in church and that are active in a youth group, when they graduate from high school, over 50% of those kids walk away from their faith in college in their early years, adult years. 50%. And of that 50%, it says 80% when they graduate from high school had no intention of walking away from their faith. Now, that may sound a little silly, like, well, of course they didn't mean to. Well, there's probably 20% that did say, the minute I get out of this house, I'm going a different direction. But if 80% of our teens grow up in a Christian home, they're active in their youth, but they fall away later in life, then we've got to kind of figure out what's going on in college years. And how do we do that? How do we deal with that? And so I've been reading this book. It's called Sticky Faith. And Sticky Faith is by Kara Powell and Chap Clark. But it talks about how do we raise kids with a sticky faith that stays outside of their years that they are in high school, when they go to college, when they're young adults. How do we have that faith that's sticky? And so there's a couple of things that they note in there and a couple of observations I have that I think we can all kind of look towards and I think are hopefully encouraging too. But I think that our kids need three things. First, I think that it's so important with our kids and our grandkids and our great-grandkids that they don't just learn about God. They don't know about God, but they know God. And there's a difference. Church is unbelievable and it's pivotal to our faith walk. But church tells you and teaches you a lot about God. But learning to actually know God, that's something admittedly that we have to decide on our own and the Holy Spirit works into. But I also think learning to know God comes from seeing what it looked like with our family members, seeing how it played out over the years and the generations, kind of like what we're talking about today. It reminds me of the stones of remembrance. I think that's one of my very favorite passages in the Bible where Joshua, they've just crossed over the river and they get to the other side and Joshua says, hey, everybody pick up your stones, get your 12 stones, let's stack up and make a memorial. And the Israelites are kind of like, why are we doing this? And he says, because we don't want to forget. We don't want our kids or our kids' kids to forget how faithful God was.
And if I could interrupt here,
sure.
I think that would be a great family thing to do, is to do those stones of remembrance, sometimes as a visual, sometimes
yeah.
with your family, that I would give mine, you would give yours, in-laws could give theirs, you know, and I think that would be something really meaningful
right.
for our children and grandchildren to see those stones of remembrances.
Right. And I think it's important because we all have those stories. I have a stone that sits on my desk that literally says, remember. To remind me of the places where God has been faithful in the past, and I know he can be faithful in the future. We all have the stories of where God came through, where he gave that paycheck we needed, where he healed that family member, that place where had he not shown up, we would have been sunk. Have we shared those? Have we passed those down? Have we taught our kids the character of God? Because we know the character of God. And so I would start with that. I would say, let's make sure that we are stacking the stones, that we are sharing those stories of faith, that we're teaching our kids not just to know about God, but who God is, his character. The second thing I would say is, let's teach them, and this is less words, more actions, but what does a real, authentic faith look like? So what does that look like day in and day out? It reminds me of when I was growing up, when I had finished law school, my mom, I was studying for the bar exam. And even after I took the bar exam, that was a hard time. I was stressed. I was worried about the test. If you don't pass the bar, I'm never going to get a job. And I remember my mom, before texting existed, and really before much email, she would mail me every day a scripture that from where I was in law school, a totally different city, she would mail me a verse. And every day I would get these verses and it was a reminder, anchor yourself in God's word. What is God's word? What do we know to be true? And so that was such a sweet thing for me, for her to show me, this is what practical, authentic faith looks like. I'm hoping with my kids that they'll look back and remember how every morning when they come downstairs, their dad's reading his Bible. He's journaling. That's what an authentic faith looks like. We all have those places that we just need to show our kids, our grandkids, our great-grandkids. What does this look like to live our faith walk? The third thing is that we need to be willing to have, and I'm taking this straight out of this book, but have sticky faith conversations. This is interesting. The research shows that talking to Christian kids, only 1 in 7 kids reported that they had talked about a spiritual issue with their mom before. 1 in 20 with their dads, that there had been that communication in the home. How about this? Only 9% of the kids they spoke to out of Christian homes, 9% said they had ever read scripture outside of the church, like in their homes. And so our kids need to see, this speaks into kind of what I'm saying, they need to see this vulnerable, authentic faith, but they need to have sticky faith conversations, these things that will help them get into college and be prepared for what they're going to be faced with. And in the areas that they talk about that the kids most need to be spoken into is, does God exist? Does he love me? Am I living the life God wants me to live? And is Christianity the only way? You don't have to be an apologist to be able to speak into those. You just have to know the Lord, right? You just have to have the Holy Spirit. And so I think this is good news. I hope this is encouragement, because as parents and grandparents, I'm just going to speak on behalf of parents and just say, grandparents and great-grandparents out there, don't stay on the sidelines. We need you more than we've ever needed you to get involved, to help us raise our kids, to help us raise this next generation of the church. And today's culture, with all that we're facing, it's going to take a lot of us. And as parents, as we're speaking into this, being overwhelmed, too many time issues we have, probably a lot that we put on ourselves, but the time constraints, we need those next generations to continue feeding into us, just like my mom's grandparents and great-grandparents' efforts are really trickling down all the way down to my daughter. And I want my efforts, and I want her efforts to go into the faith journeys of kids, of relatives we will never meet, because we're just faithful, and we love the Lord, and we're willing to share. And so step out there. Get off the sidelines if you are, but step out there. Speak into the lives of your kids. Pray over them. I think one of the most significant things my mom has always done, and my dad, has prayed over myself, really me, but really my kids, my husband, praying over our family. That's a great starting point. But you have stories that need to be told. You have influence that needs to be shared. And so that's my encouragement as you're passing down your legacy of faith. And so with that, I think my mom has some practical ways that she's done that as a grandparent. So I'm handing it off.
Okay. Those are good words, Cynthia, and they're challenging words. And I hope that all of us can take those to heart. And as a grandparent, we are a support to parents. You know, I am not Kate's parent, even though I would like to be, because she's precious and I love her. But we are a support to you, to help you. And particularly if it's a Christian home, how we can feed into that and be a support. And just some of the things that, you know, we've done through the years. When my first grandchild was born, and he's now 25 years old, I can't believe it. But I decided to pick a scripture for each grandchild that I would pray over them. Well, our first grandchild's name is Caleb, and I loved that scripture in the Old Testament about Caleb, one of the 12 spies that went into the Promised Land, and 10 came back and said, oh, there's giants, we can't do it. But Caleb said, yes, we can. God's already promised it to us. We can do it. But it says about Caleb, he had a different spirit and followed God wholeheartedly. So I found that in my Bible, and I put Caleb's picture in my Bible by that scripture. Then his brother Connor came along, and I thought about David and a man after God's own heart. Then Cade, the third boy in the same family, came along, and I thought about Joseph and how his brother sold him into bondage, you know, and not knowing what his older brothers would do. And there's a scripture about how do we find a man like this. Kate came along, and one of my favorite scriptures is that the Lord will honor and protect those whose heart is completely his. And I have prayed over and over for Kate that her heart would be completely his. Brett came along. I know the plans I have for you to not harm you, but to honor you and to prosper you. And then, of course, JB was our precious boy adopted into the family. And so from Ephesians 1, when it talks about we are adopted into God's family. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I've taken those verses, and then what I've done is just paste their picture in by that scripture in my Bible. And through the years, I've just prayed those verses for my grandchildren. And that's just one way to pray for them. I think another way of support, and Kate can tell you about this, but I write letters to them, and I don't handwrite anymore.
Do you? I brought one. Okay. One of the birthday letters.
Okay. So on their birthday, and I write a letter, and I just kind of review the year. I usually put in pictures of events from the last year, but I also challenge them in their Christian walk. I affirm their parents and what their parents are doing for them. and I encouraged them in the year ahead. I used a scripture that I've prayed for them. And it doesn't have to be just, you know, on a birthday. It can be any time when they graduate from high school, when they graduate from college, or significant events when they're baptized. Did you show that?
When each of my kids have been baptized, or my first two, my little one has not been baptized yet. My mom had something made, and this was a plate for Kate, and then, you want to hold this one? And then that's in my son's room, and it has their name and a scripture she's prayed over them, and then on the back, we all signed it as a family. But this hangs in their rooms. It has a date that they were baptized, the date, actually, they accepted Christ, and the date they were baptized, and the verse that we've prayed over, that my mom's been praying over them. And just that reminder that she had these made for our kids, it hangs in their room as a reminder. That's a significant date. That matters.
Well, you know, I need to think another thing, and when I was senior adult minister, I really encouraged this, and I have to admit I've not been good at this, but I think our children and our grandchildren know our salvation experience. And in one sentence, mine was, I was raised in the church, as you just heard. But one Sunday morning, I had taken a friend to church, and she wanted to know how to become a Christian. And I'm standing there explaining that to her, realizing I've never really made that public in my life. And so I walked the aisle that day and shook the pastor's hand and said, I want to accept Jesus as my Savior. And that was a defining moment in my life. And the other defining moment was when I was a freshman in college and God called me into ministry. So I think our children and our grandchildren around the Thanksgiving table or the Christmas tree or whatever need to know our salvation experience. And of course, the greatest thing as grandparents that we can do is prayer. I have to brag, my daughter wrote this prayer journal. And it has a prayer for each week, you know, marked by wisdom, marked by favor. So I got one, and I pray from these attributes for my grandchildren. But it dawned on me when I first started praying for my grandchildren, these attributes, my children need it as much as my grandchildren. So I am praying for my children and my grandchildren, marked by generosity, marked by truth, marked by maturity. And so there's all kinds of resources out there, but prayer is the best thing. And occasionally Kate will text me and say, Granddaughter, I have a test tomorrow, pray for me. And boy, I'm on there. One of my older grandsons had surgery last week. I was on there, you know, and to let them know. And it's easy now with emojis. You know, you can text them and just put the praying hands there and let them know that you are praying for them. And that's just the greatest privilege. Right now I'm praying for Kate and what college she goes to. And I have an opinion, but I'm not expressing my opinion. I'm just praying for God's perfect will in her life for her to go. I would also say you could memorize scripture with your children or your grandchildren. Haven't had a lot of success with that, but I have encouraged
we apologize.
You know, them to memorize scripture. That has been one of the greatest ways of growth in my spiritual life is to memorize scripture. And of course, just be relevant. You know, they're not going to really read too much of what you write for them, but text them, emojis, you know, be relevant in communication with your grandchildren. I read someplace that one mother had put her calendar from her phone onto her grandmother's calendar so that the grandmother could know when there's doctor's appointments, tests, sporting events, concerts. I'm not sure that I want all of that on my calendar.
You don't.
That would be a lot. But that way you know when they've been to the doctor's appointment, is everything okay? Or when they have a test and I can pray for them. So be a part of their life as a support for them. I think another that's really meant a lot to me is to be involved in their lives through mission projects. For about the last 10 years, Cynthia and neighborhood friends have made lunches for Brother Bill's in the summer when children don't have enough to eat. And different times, Kate and Brett, we've gone to the dollar store and we've bought bananas. My Sunday school class is so generous, they give money so that we can put fruit into these sack lunches. Well, we go to the dollar store and we're counting off bananas. We need 300 bananas. And then we have this cart filled with bananas. Well, it's just hysterical. I mean, everybody's looking at us like, what on earth are you doing? And just to have that mission opportunity with my grandchildren and then be there when they put the lunches together and take them. Or we've also gone to the dollar store and filled up shoe boxes, you know, to send to children. So those kinds of things of being involved in missions with them. And then, of course, sporting events. Been to more softball and baseball games than I ever wanted to, but I'm there and I'm cheering them on. And Friday night football games with my older grandsons. And when they all graduated, I really missed the Friday night games. But concerts, sporting events, all of those kinds of things, you know, are really important. But let me just, I'll conclude my part by saying this, that as a grandparent, my husband and I, we're role models for our grandchildren. And that's really, really important. Our grandchildren haven't seen the early days of our lives. They see the last days of our lives. So they don't know about all the mistakes that we made. And I think it's probably good for we as grandparents to share the mistakes that we made in college, as young adults, meeting adults, and yet how God has been faithful through those mistakes and that they're going to make mistakes. But that God is going to be faithful to them and he's going to redeem those mistakes. And the older I get, I realize my mistakes as a parent, as Cynthia says on every podcast, there are no perfect parents but a perfect God. And I ask God to redeem the mistakes that I made as a parent. And he is doing that and he will do that. And so we need to continue to pray for that. Each generation sets the stage for the next generation. And I'm so grateful that my grandparents and my parents, and I've been able to pass it on to my children and grandchildren, but it is a joy. Oh, what a joy it is to see the results of faith through the generations, to leave the legacy and to leave it for your children and your grandchildren and see the God and Holy Spirit working through their lives. That's probably the greatest joy you can have as a grandparent.
Mm, that's so good. And so I would just say, be encouraged. I would say get involved, figure out ways, pray about it, ask your kids or grandkids ways that you can be involved in their life, that you can stay relevant, that you can share your faith story. The need is great, and you have a voice that no one else has to speak into the lives of your kids, your grandkids, your great-grandkids. And so I would just encourage you to do that, as together we're all trying to pass down this legacy of faith, asking the Lord to honor the places where we've been faithful and to redeem the places where we haven't done as well. And so I just encourage us all to walk that road together. And I'm so thankful that my family's gotten to do this. I'm thankful for Park City Baptist Church and how much of a role it's played in our family, and I just look forward to many more years of doing this together as family.
Shall we pray together?
I'd love to. Did you want to add anything else, Kate?
No, that's great.
Okay, I'll pray for us. Father, how we thank you for your love and how we thank you for your faithfulness and how your faith is passed down from generation to generation. So I just thank you and praise you that I came from Christian grandparents and parents where I didn't have to search and struggle in my life to know you as Savior and Lord, and that I've been able to, Tom and I, to pass that on to our children and to our grandchildren. What a great privilege it is, Father. And I do pray for our grandchildren today, Lord. It's a difficult world. And I just pray for your faithfulness, your presence, your wisdom for them, all the things that they need, and in a different way than I did it growing up, but the ways that they will approach you and live for you, know your will, be obedient to you, Father, just protect them and help them in their growth through you. Father, we love you and we thank you for who you are in our lives. In your holy, precious name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.